for tonight's forum. This is the second in a series of forums dealing with the general topic of sustainability. Tonight's topic is alternative renewable energy sources, transforming our energy economy. These forums are sponsored by the Radnor Conservancy, the Radnor League of Women Voters, and the Radnor Township Environmental Advisory Council. A housekeeping issue to begin with. There is a sign-up sheet in the back. We'd like you to sign up and put down your email address. As I said, this is the second in a series. We have at least two forums scheduled for next year, so you want to make sure that you're on the mailing list. If you're watching from home and you want to be included in our email list in the future, contact the Radnor Conservancy at radnorconservancy@comcast.net and leave a message that you want to be included in the sustainability series email list. We have assembled an expert panel of four experts. Each will speak for no more than 20 minutes. If they're speaking for more than 20 minutes, polite applause from the audience is probably in order. This will allow us time for questions at the end. We will wrap up promptly at 9 o'clock. President Obama has long maintained that developing a viable alternative energy sources is one of the three legs in his stool of economic recovery. It is easy to understand the rationale for this policy. Most of the petroleum in the world is controlled by countries which either don't like us very much or are politically unstable. Second, our continued reliance on fossil fuels is exacerbating our global warming problem. It is easy to formulate this policy. However, it is entirely a different matter to implement the policy. And tonight, what we want to talk about are the steps that are required to implement this policy. What are the practical issues involved in developing alternative energy sources? What are the most practical sources? How quickly can these sources be developed, and at what cost? In the short run, is conservation our most viable option? Our first three speakers are going to discuss alternative energy sources that we might be able to develop in the future. Many of these are existing now, but they're not existing at levels that are really making a major impact on our energy resources. Our fourth speaker is going to address the conservation issue. Is that really the step that we should be focusing on at this point in the short run? Because we're going to see, as we talk about some of the practical issues, some of the problems and some of the costs involved in trying to develop some of these alternative energy sources. Without any further ado, I want to start by introducing our first speaker. Brett Altifer, all the way over on the right, is going to talk about wind energy. Brent is the Executive Vice President with Iberdrola Renewables, the leader in the world with renewable energy generation. In 1999, Brent formed the company Community Energy, Inc., which was subsequently sold to Iberdrola. Prior to forming Community Energy, Brent was a practicing lawyer for about 15 years, I think, out in Denver. And then when the firm that he was with closed the Denver office, you decided to look into other options. At one point, then you became the Colorado Public Utility Commissioner before forming Community Energy. One question that I'd like to ask you before at some point in your presentation, Iberdrola is a Spanish company, and my understanding is, at least in the wind industry, if not all the major industries, most of these companies that are big hitters are foreign companies. Are we late to the table, or is my impression incorrect? Yes, absolutely.
Yes, John, and thank you for the introduction. There are many countries around the world got a jump on wind energy ahead of the U.S., and Europe includes many of them.
Denmark is the lead in terms of the amount of wind energy that they produce, in terms of the percentage of what they use. And Spain and Germany come closely behind. So really, they got to jump on it by putting policies in place to develop alternative energy earlier. And as a result, a lot of the leadership comes from those countries that got to jump on it. How to incorporate it into the grid. They dealt earlier with myths that renewable resources, which are intermittent, could not be combined with the utility grid, and they worked through some of those issues earlier. So as a result, they've shown us the way in many areas. But now the wind industry has attracted a good bit of large capital from U.S. Companies as well. And I'll try to give you a picture of that in the context of what does it take to get to a sustainable energy future. Wind is only one part of that. It's a part that's here now, and it's something we can develop ahead of most of the other generation resources. So I'll try to give you a picture of that quickly in the next 19 minutes.
Okay.
So first, the generation in the U.S. Electricity generation. We get about 50% of our generation from coal in the U.S. We have a lot of coal, and we've developed a lot, particularly in the 40s and 50s and 60s, and we haven't developed a lot since. And it's part of what you'll see makes up our challenge in the energy industry. About 20% now comes from natural gas. And natural gas generation was developed much more recently, really in the last 10 years. There was a big push on natural gas generation, partly because the technology got better, combined cycle natural gas generation got cheaper, and partly because that was a fuel that was available that didn't face some of the environmental challenges that coal did. So we're now 20% gas. We're 19% nuclear, most built in the 60s and 70s, and not much since, Three Mile Island. We're about 7% of the generation from hydro, a lot of big hydro. Here's the Grand Coulee Dam, developed a long time ago, 60, 70, and some 100 years ago in some of them. But we're still, that's an emission-free resource. Not a lot of new hydro being built either, especially large hydro, because of impacts on water, which is increasingly in short supply, and the environmental mitigation that's required to go with large hydro operations. So we're about 7% hydro nationally, and wind is now up to about 2%, gained from 1 to 2% just in the last 18 months. Been a big push on wind energy in the U.S. And solar is still maybe more than a tenth, we'll hear from Sarah Hetznecker, maybe up to two, certainly less than 1% solar at this point. Solar has a lot of the promise, in my view, of wind. That is, costs coming down. Wind of 10 years ago, costs were coming down while general electricity prices were going up. So I think solar fills in a gap in the future and is in a race for what is left behind after efficiency and wind. So what's the issue with energy generation? Because we're 50% coal, there are two things we get, several things, but two principal ones. One is acid rain formation is principally caused by electric generation. And there's not only damage to streams and water and fish, but there's increasingly evidence and more and more discovery of what it does just to trees. There's root uptake issues that result when you get acid rain concentration over a period of years. And there have been whole stands of trees in the ridges of North Carolina that are gone based on acid rain. So we don't hear so much about acid rain anymore because there is an acid rain program in place that's basically been hitting its goals. But many realize that even if we are successful in hitting our 2010 acid rain goals, we still have a long way to go in terms of cleaning up. And the Northeast, Pennsylvania Northeast, is ground zero on acid rain. It's very important. One of the things acid rain does, in addition to biological damage, is dissolves limestone. Here's a picture of a sculpture. This is not from Pennsylvania, but if you go to Valley Forge Park and you go by the Valley Forge Chapel, you can see for yourself very easily damage from acid rain to that chapel, and they're dealing with what restoration and what mitigation efforts might be required on just that one structure from acid rain in Pennsylvania. You multiply that across the country and the world, and you see we've got major impact from our electricity generation. The next one is climate change, which you're hearing more about now, obviously. But while there, some say there's still debate on climate change, this graph, I think, shows as well as anything. This is a graph of concentration. The top graph is concentration of carbon in the atmosphere from 1751 to the present. And the bottom graph is annual discharge of carbon into the atmosphere over the same period. So you can see in 1751, used as a base, we've increased carbon emissions in the atmosphere basically every year. When there's economic downturn, there's a little bit less. You see the jiggle in the curve. But independent of that, what it does long term is it slowly trickles carbon into the atmosphere and changes the greenhouse effect. And the greenhouse effect we like, the greenhouse effect is what gives us our habitable temperatures, an average temperature of about 70 degrees worldwide, which has already increased about 1 degree worldwide because we're changing the greenhouse. So we're changing the glass in the greenhouse in with a constant drip change of carbon every year. So you could argue about what the impacts of changing the greenhouse are, but you can't argue that we're changing the greenhouse. And increasingly, there's less and less debate on the fact that we need to do something about it. This curve cannot continue to go in this direction forever. Most curves that look like that, even from basic mathematics, you know, are not sustainable. It has to go somewhere. It can't go up forever. You can't change the greenhouse forever. So we're finally getting at least some recognition, policy recognition, that this is what we have to do. So electricity generation. There's basically two big sources of carbon emissions. There's petroleum and there's coal. Natural gas is a little bit on the top, but natural gas is a much cleaner. Many people, including myself, think of natural gas as the bridge to renewables because it's the best fossil fuel. Alone, it's not going to get us there, but if we could rely more on that instead of unscrubbed coal and petroleum, we'd be in a lot better shape. Petroleum basically comes from the transportation sector, and the coal use basically comes in the electricity sector. So those are the two segments of your life that are contributing to climate change. So let's look at the electricity sector, which is basically coal. And you see we get 40% of greenhouse gases from electricity generation, and 70% of the acid rain is from electricity generation. So this is one of the things that moved me to move from practicing law into renewable energy, is this is one segment that alone can make a huge difference if we can solve the problem. And emissions in the electricity generation are solvable. This is a puzzle where we have some answers. Here's a picture of wind energy production worldwide in terms of percentage of use. And these are the countries I mentioned earlier have led the way. Denmark, Spain, Portugal, Germany, approaching 10%, and Denmark 20% of all of their electricity use from wind. So they've solved the issue of intermittent resource, using it when it's available, and having the grid, basically natural gas, provide energy as a backup when it's not available. So the notion that this is an intermittent resource, we can't use it, at least to 20%, which is a big part, and what I would set as the goal for wind contribution to a sustainable energy future should be about 20% of your use nationally from wind. It's very doable. It's been shown. We were at about 1% after a big push in production last year. We're about 2% in the U.S. of energy use from wind. So the potential's there. Cost. So you hear a lot about cost. These are too expensive. We need to rely on coal and nuclear because that's the inexpensive fuel. The facts are a little bit different, so keep this in mind as you hear these arguments. What you see here from NREL, the National Renewable Energy Laboratory, is the cost in cents per kilowatt hour of electricity to you. Basically, it's a wholesale cost, but eventually to you. First on the left, from depreciated coal and nuclear. So those plants that we built in the 50s, 60s, and 70s, like an old car, as long as they keep running, you can keep them running without much capital cost, just the cost of fuel, and you can do it on a fairly inexpensive basis. That's what people are talking about when they say conventional power is cheaper. It's the plants we built in the 50s, 60s, and 70s. Natural gas, which we're building now, is shown there as much higher cost, and it's basically all fuel costs, so it's very volatile. But you see that that's not cheap power. That's 6 to 8 cents a kilowatt hour, and it's the average of those two. Remember, coal was 50%. Nuclear was another 19, so 69% from depreciated plants versus 20% and above from new resources. You average those together, you get the red line, which is the cost annually, wholesale cost of electricity, and you see how it moved up as we added more natural gas to the mix. You'll also see my projection. It's only one of where I think wholesale electricity prices are going, and I think they're going up. It may or may not be good news, but that's because the options for new generation are fairly limited, and they're all more expensive than using the old plants we built in the 50s. So first, the cost of new wind. It's now comparable with natural gas in most parts of the country. So you can add new wind at the same cost of electricity as you can natural gas. And that's what's happening. We're building a lot of wind generation. Depreciated wind, It's actually one of the, not only the only renewable resource maybe that's available at these costs, but it's the only resource, period, where you can forecast a depreciated cost. Once we invest the capital in wind, there's no fuel. So it's like buying your house with a 30-year mortgage. When you buy it, over 30 years, you own it. You invest the capital, you own it. That's how it is with wind. So the cost of energy from depreciated wind, which we're beginning to see, because we did build some wind 20 years ago, but we invest now, 20 years from now, we continue to use this capital investment with no cost of fuel. You see the cost of depreciated wind as projected by the National Renewable Energy Library is right down there with depreciated coal and nuclear. So it's all capital, no fuel. So the more we invest now, the more we can claim later we have cheap energy, just like we're doing now with coal and nuclear. Now, when you compare the price of adding new coal, and we haven't added much, if any, new coal in the United States, it's actually more expensive than wind to do a new coal plant. And this is without scrubbing for carbon. This is just with current emission controls, new coal. If you talk about clean coal or carbon sequestration and what we're going to do to use coal, which we have abundantly, in a way that doesn't add to climate change, then your costs are much higher. They're much higher. And nuclear, we're seeing some attempts to build nuclear, is facing the same thing. We're seeing costs of energy above 10 cents a kilowatt hour in terms of projected capital costs of building a new nuclear plant today. So this notion that conventional power is cheaper isn't quite the case. What is the case is we actually do not have yet the full range of options that we need at even the costs of coal and nuclear to have a clean energy future. The one that we have now and the one we're investing in and should be is wind. The goal actually set by the previous administration, the Bush administration, and continued now under the Obama administration, is let's get to 20% of the electricity consumption in the U.S. from wind energy. Other countries have shown we can do it. We've got the wind resource to do it. It's a matter of investing the capital, finding the capital and making the investment. So that's now the goal, actually, of the Department of Energy. And we're actually on our way. There's a good bit. We've got to get to about 20 times where we are, 10 to 20 times where we are. But it's doable. So this is the one piece of a sustainable energy future that doesn't take a whole lot of research and development. It just takes implementation. Get the wind built and get it connected to the grid. In terms of what it can do for CO2, here are some curves of what the electric sector CO2 emissions would be, the top curve, without wind. If you didn't build new wind, the carbon emissions from the electric sector continue to go up through the year 2030. The middle case is the 20% wind. If we get to 20% wind, that's the wedge. That's the difference we can make on the CO2 emissions. Basically, we can hold them flat. Just with the wind piece. We can hold our emissions flat in the electricity sector by going to 20% wind. And the green curve is the path that some have posited in federal law as the goal by 2050, the path to 60% of CO2 emissions below today's level by 2060 is the green curve. So you can see we have a way to go, and you can see the proportion that wind can provide. The rest, efficiency, solar, some say nuclear, some say coal with carbon sequestration. But that's what's remaining. The wind piece is the most certain. We've got to get to the rest. Efficiency is also cost effective. So those are the two we can do now. Here's another view of that worldwide, globally. The Princeton Carbon Mitigation Initiative has come up with a way of looking at the climate problem that talks about eight wedges of reduction. Eight wedges of reduction that could save about 1 billion tons of carbon per year implemented over a 50-year time frame. And one of those eight wedges is wind. One is solar, and what it would require is about 2 million megawatts of wind installed worldwide. When they did this study, they said that would be increasing wind by a factor of 30. We've already made progress on that. So today, it's increasing wind by a factor of somewhat less than 20, 15 to 20 worldwide. And the amount of wind we have versus the amount of wind to be built would give us that one wedge on carbon change. So you can see it gives some hope for those of us that like to at least see our way forward on how we deal with environmental problems. Is there an answer? Is there a way? Is there something we can do? The wind piece is one we can do. Here's one we built, a wind farm in Bear Creek up in the Poconos in Pennsylvania. That's what it looks like. Some say we can't site them where people can see them. I think that's just perfect beauty myself. It's kinetic art in the finest form, but beauty's in the eye of the beholder, so we're going to have to put them where people want them. And in areas with sometimes low economic output, and farms can get good land income from this, about $6,000 per year per turbine, without using up much of the land, so you can continue to farm or do whatever you're doing with the land. And as I also tell people that don't like development, there are not many forms of economic development that we post a bond at the start that in 20 years pays for decommissioning and taking down the turbines. So what form of income can you count on? A shopping center won't do that, and neither will tourist housing, and neither will a shopping center in any other form. So here you've got part of the solution to climate change in an economic way with a bond that'll take it down in 20 years if you want, and it's landowner income. So wind really is one solution that we need to move on now, in my view. Obviously, that's why I went into it. There's an Atlantic City wind farm we built on a sewage treatment plant. Again, the winds on the ocean are very good, so we took advantage of those winds, but we did it at a developed site, a sewage treatment plant, and didn't mar the beach use. That's also a successful wind farm. Here, I'll just give you a couple slides of how wind came on in the U.S., and you can just take a minute and watch as it developed. It'll give you a sense of where the wind is. When we started 8 years ago, there was very little, none in the Northeast. And this will just give you, as the green gets darker, that's the amount of wind and concentration that's come on. It'll just give you a picture of how it's developed over the last 8 years across the country. So you see where it's filled in. Pennsylvania now is actually at about 460 megawatts, starting at zero. Texas and California are in thousands of megawatts of wind, but there's a lot more that we can do in the U.S. We're at about 25,000 megawatts of wind currently, and to get to our 20% wind, we'd have to get to 350,000. So again, we're now between 10 and 20 times our current amount of wind, and we've got our 20% solution on sustainable energy. So in summary, some things to remember about Pennsylvania is we currently contribute 1% of the world supply of global greenhouse gases in Pennsylvania. I'm always astounded by that number. We need to realize our impact. We are, in the state, 1% of the total greenhouse gas problem. 1% of the carbon wedge, that is, if we took on our responsibility for getting that 1/8 piece that wind energy can supply around the world, we would need to build 20,000 megawatts of wind in Pennsylvania. Just trying to give you some sense of the numbers. We know we've demonstrated the capability to bring on 5,000 megawatts of wind. So we know we can do that part of the global climate change challenge. And we currently have just under 500 megawatts. And that's been built in the last 6 to 7 years. So that's a picture of the wind piece on sustainable energy and Pennsylvania's role. And it's one that is here. It takes some political will. It takes some engineering. It takes some capital. But it is not anything more than that in terms of costs and needed R&D. It's why I went into why I left practice of law with all the benefits it holds to develop wind energy 6 or 7 years ago. And we have more to do.
Thank you. As I said at the beginning, we're going to hold all the questions until the end, but start to think of your questions because we will have time to ask all of our speakers whatever questions are on your mind about any of these alternative energy sources. Sarah Hetzdecker is our next speaker, and she's going to talk about solar. She's going to tell us how we're going to get more than 0.1% or whatever ghastly figure Brent has assigned to your industry. Sarah is the Director of Project Development for Kind Energy Projects, Inc. She's responsible for the strategic direction of the project groups and for the development of projects nationwide. In her over 20 years of experience in this area, she has been involved in the development of over 250 solar projects, and according to Brett's numbers, that would be all of the solar projects in the country, I believe. Okay. She also chairs today the Pennsylvania State Climate Change Advisory Committee. Sarah, you're on.
Let me just get my presentation open. Great. Great. Thank you very much. No, the 250 projects, a lot of them, and that's projects, not megawatts, that's a lot of small-scale projects that were built primarily in Pennsylvania and New Jersey. I'm just going to talk a little bit about some projects that we've done, a little bit about Conergy, and then really talk about the market overview, how solar works, and really what solar means in terms of getting financed and getting projects in the ground. So Conergy is a global country. We're in a global company. We're in 26 countries worldwide. We've been involved in or participated in installing 1 gigawatt of renewable energy over the past 10 years. I'm not going to go into much more about Conergy. I do want to show some different types of installations. The thing about solar is it is pretty versatile, and you can use it in many different locations. So there's distributed energy, agricultural applications, public buildings, telecommunications. There's free field plants, off-grid, on-grid, all different kinds of solar projects, and I'll get into some of those and how they work as we go along. Here's some pictures, and I always show lots of solar pictures because I think they're really beautiful, and solar's really beautiful, and again, as I said, there's so many different ways to apply solar. These are two rooftop installations. One on the left is in California. It's 1.2 megawatts, and over 25 years, that system will offset about 124 million car miles. The one on the right is a Michelin tire plant in Germany, and that's a 10-megawatt rooftop installation, one of the largest rooftop installations. These two are solar tracking systems. The other systems that I showed you were stationary systems. These are tracking, and so they're designed to track with the sun to produce maximum output. Here's a couple. The one on the left is one that we built here in Pennsylvania, the largest solar power plant east of the Mississippi. It's 3 megawatts, and that was built in Falls Township, Bucks County, right adjacent to a filled area on Groves Landfill. It's a buffer area adjacent to the actual filled area. The center one is South San Joaquin Irrigation District, and the one on the right is 24 megawatts that we did in Korea. And again, it's just to give you an idea of all the different types of solar applications that are out there. This is a close-up sort of the plant up in Bucks County. And if you have a chance to go by it, it is quite something to see. Here's a couple more free field and rooftops, some wineries, and a rice facility in California. This one I really like. The one on the left is in St. Moritz, and this is building integrated PV, which is something that I think we'll see more and more of. As new facades are built for buildings, you can have the PV right attached to the facade generating electricity. The one on the right is some solar canopies attached to a building, and these are another application that I also think we'll see more and more of. And again, another solar tracker system, some more big, large-scale installations. This is another, we will be building three new projects in Pennsylvania with this type of system. This is a carport. Now, our carports that we're building in Pennsylvania aren't going to be quite this architecturally stunning, but there will be, and this is another application that we're seeing more and more, especially in shopping malls. Cars get in California and some of the other places where cars get so hot. And so you put the solar on, you reduce the heat going into the car and produce electricity for the facility. So that's just a little bit about some beautiful projects. Now I'm going to talk about how it works. So solar PV, and that's what we're talking about this evening, is the direct conversion of sunlight to electricity. And this was actually discovered in 1839. It's clean, quiet, inexhaustible power source. It's one of the most reliable power sources there is. It's very predictable. We use 30 years of weather data to calculate the output. And there are modules, solar panels, up in space right now that are still working that were initially set off with the first satellites in the early 60s. And another point, I think it was brought up, that some of the other countries around the world are further ahead than the U.S. And Germany is definitely further ahead than in the U.S. in solar power implementation. And one of the major issues, reasons for that, is policy. And we also see Korea was advanced in solar energy. I'm not Korea, Japan and Spain, and again, policy. And I think it will be a challenge for the U.S. to really gain ground in that area. So it's predictable and reliable output. It produces energy when we need it most. And the bottom line, for most customers looking at solar, they want to see the financial return. Whether you're a homeowner or you're someone building a large-scale solar energy park, it's a financial deal. And we'll talk about that a little further on. So again, what makes solar work? Electric utility deregulation, net metering rules, interconnection rules, portfolio standards, those are the policy issues. And we have all of those in Pennsylvania, and I'll get into that a little bit more. Then the other thing is technology. We have inverters, increased module efficiency, various mounting solutions so we can install these in many different places, and then tracker technology. So one of the things I'd like to say about inverters is years ago when we talked about solar photovoltaics, it was always DC power. And the onset or the development of inverters that was able to convert the DC power to grid quality AC power is really what helped spur the widespread use of solar for homes and businesses. Again, I just want to talk a little bit more about policy and relate this to Pennsylvania. So utility rates is another issue, interconnection. So in Pennsylvania, we have interconnection rules that allow us to interconnect to the grid and get paid by the utility at retail rates, and that's a big issue. Net metering as well. So another thing is you want to hook into your main service panel of your house with solar, and you want to be able to get credit for that electricity that you've generated. And then incentives, and we're seeing incentives all over the country, and I'll talk about that again a little further along. So in Pennsylvania, New Jersey, we have some of these, and California and some other states, we have the pillars that we need to really, the policy that helps drive solar deployment. So I think someone mentioned earlier, you know, policy is the easy part. Policy has actually been very challenging for solar, but we'll talk about that. So again, I want to go back to solar. I think even people that have worked in the solar industry sometimes get confused about this. So there's net meter, the whole idea behind solar. When you talk about wind or a coal plant, that's a plant that's feeding directly into the grid, and the power companies are buying that generation. When we're looking at solar, you're net metering. You're feeding into the main service panel of your house, and you're offsetting your load at retail rates. And that's the primary benefit of solar today. What we are seeing is utility scale solar, which is what we built up in Falls Township, where we're actually hooking into, it's a power plant. There's no load that we're offsetting. We're hooking into the utility grid. And we're seeing a greater development of that power, of that type of installation, because of the policies that have been implemented and are being implemented. So two different ways to interconnect solar. One is net metered, and the other is utility scale. So this is just a this is just an example of solar. So you have modules on the roof or in the field or on the building, and the sun shines on those modules, and it creates DC power. The DC power goes into this inverter, this magic inverter, which converts it to grid quality AC power. That is then interconnected to the main service panel of your house. When the sun is shining, you're producing solar energy. It goes into all the loads in your house, and you're not drawing anything from the grid, and you're offsetting anything you might be drawing from the grid. At nighttime, when there's no sun, you're drawing seamlessly from the grid. That's interconnection. Net metering is at the end of the month. They're going to look at your bill. They're going to see how much you produced, how much you used, and they're going to subtract it. And hopefully, you've produced more solar energy than grid energy that you've used. And that's the financial proposition for the customer. So you pay this capital cost, but hopefully you reduced your bill to nothing. And then there's some incentives that help offset those capital costs. So this is just a slide to indicate how complex the U.S. Electric utility market is. So we have the national transmission network. We have regional transmission organizations. We have regulated markets and deregulated markets. And then we have publicly owned utilities, investor-owned utilities, independent power producers, all different kinds of players in the market. And how the regulations for solar are written sort of drive where you can actually do a solar project. So we talked about policy and the pillars. One of the biggest policy initiatives that we've seen across 33 states, and now there's a drive for having this across the country, is a renewable portfolio standard. And what the renewable portfolio standard does is it sets forth a requirement that the utilities in that state have to get to a specific amount of renewables by a certain date, a percentage of renewables by a certain date. And so we have 33 states that have renewable portfolio standards. Pennsylvania is one of those. Then we have within the renewable portfolio standard, and I'm sorry if this is complicated, but it is complicated, and I'm trying to simplify it. We have a solar carve-out, and the solar carve-out is what really makes solar work in these RPS states, as we call them. So what happens is when you have a renewable portfolio standard, in order for the utilities to, in this state anyway, for the utilities to demonstrate that they've reached their goal for renewable energy, they can buy what's called a solar renewable energy credit. And that drives the market in this state and in New Jersey. So if you're a homeowner, and a solar renewable energy credit is a megawatt of clean renewable energy that's been generated. So for example, every kilowatt hour produced from a solar energy system has associated with it the solar renewable energy credit that is tradable on the open market. And the utilities, to demonstrate that they've achieved their compliance, they will buy those solar renewable energy credits. And that's another way for the capital, the person who outlaid the capital for this system, to offset the capital cost. And I'll show you a slide about that. So key markets are driven by solar carve-outs and effective policy. So I just want to reiterate that. Why isn't solar all over the country? Because these are the states that really have the policies that make it financially feasible for solar to happen. This is, again, just another slide to show you how easy it is to understand the solar renewable energy market. So we have different state programs. We have 50 states, clearly, and each state applies these policies differently. And so there's solar renewable, you know, these RPSs, and some of them the utilities have to go out and buy all the solar renewable energy credits directly from a developer. Some say no, they can buy it from anybody. So it's very complex to really navigate the waters and find the right place where these projects can work. And that's really the purpose of that slide, just to demonstrate. Then we have the economic stimulus package. And this had a lot of elements in it that really will help shore up and drive solar deployment. One of the things that has driven solar development is an investment tax credit. So anyone who installs a solar system gets a tax credit for it. The stimulus plan extended that tax credit for 8 years. It's 30%. And they also enabled people to take that tax credit as a rebate directly from the Department of Treasury, the Treasury Department. So for those entities that don't pay taxes, they now have the ability to access that as a rebate. And again, the idea is to extend to create more deployment, obviously. Then there's loan guarantees, subsidized financing, bonus depreciation, all kinds of things that you can apply to your project to really get the return on the investment where you need it to be. And all of this really goes back to the fact, and Brent brought this up, is the cost of installation. And solar is the costliest form of renewable energy today. And there's a lot of reasons for that. One is, the policies have not been there. We have not invested very much money in solar energy. All the other forms of energy that we use have gotten a lot of investment over the years. And I don't have the exact figures, but solar energy has really received the least amount of investment. So it's kind of playing catch up. We've seen a lot of improvements in technology. And those improvements include module efficiency. And so, again, we're seeing costs come down. And the more we deploy, manufacturing costs get cheaper, everything gets cheaper, and we'll see those costs come down. So the solar market, we believe that we'll see California, New Jersey continue to lead the deployment of solar, and that's purely because of policy in those two states. Pennsylvania is very closely behind. We're going to see as the utility, as the rate caps come off in 2010 and 2011, we're going to see a lot more solar installed in Pennsylvania. In the past, we've seen the primary market segment as residential rooftops, and we're seeing the utility scale grow. And again, this is driven by the fact that utilities do have this requirement. And in California, they can't buy solar renewable energy credits to demonstrate their compliance. So utilities are building solar power plants in California. And we'll see a lot of that happening. Then there's some other states that we're going to be seeing coming online, lots of new things happening. And I guess the other point I want to make is that the solar industry is rapidly changing and constantly changing as policies change and new states come online and the stimulus package gets passed and all kinds of things and are happening in policy. So a solar deal is a financial deal. I want to go back to this because many people think that people will buy solar just on the environmental benefits alone. And that's not the case today. So the deal components for solar energy is the first and foremost primary one is this 30% federal tax credit. And then in each state, there's various incentives. So you take the cost of the project, you apply the tax credit, and then you look at whatever incentive is in that state. In Pennsylvania and New Jersey, we have solar renewable energy credits that you can trade. And those go for 25 cents a kilowatt hour to 60 cents a kilowatt hour. In California, they have a performance-based incentive, and so they'll pay you 22 cents a kilowatt hour for every clean, in addition to the offset of your electricity. So I'm sorry if I'm getting into too many details. Then you have the avoided cost of the electricity, and those combined provide the economic return to the person who's outlaying the capital to buy the system. And we're seeing returns on renewable solar projects, 5 to 10 years, depending upon the state, the size, the incentives. Are you doing solar tree, the application? And really quickly, I'm just going to talk about the way people can finance a solar energy project. You can buy the system outright. There's leasing options, and then there's power purchase agreements. Power purchase agreements are where the customer doesn't own the system. They just buy the power from the system. A third party owns the system. They reap all the economic benefits from that system. So then there's here we just talk about various finance lease options. And this is something that we're seeing more and more for homeowners is leasing solutions. So rather than laying out the money to buy the system, you can lease it from the just an equipment lease from the solar installer. And it usually 5 to 10 year lease term, and after the term of the lease, you own the system. All the energy from that system is free. And one of the things I do want to say about the solar technology is that modules are warrantied for 25 years, and they are working for 30 to 40 years. And all the energy produced is free once you've recovered your capital costs. There's no fuel costs. So I'm not going to go into all this financing options, but these are all the customer groups that would finance and basically either a lease or a PPA option. Thank you very much. I appreciate being here tonight.
Next speaker is John Nagel, who's been in the energy business 40-plus years at this point?
Just 40.
All right, just 40. Most recently with PICO Energy, where he has been actively involved in the development of PICO's nuclear plants, and I think PICO probably, John, correct me if I'm wrong, has as many nuclear plants or as much nuclear capacity as most of our utility companies around the country.
Well, PICO's part of Exelon, and Exelon is the largest, but even before that, PICO was one of the largest. what it was called those days, SECO, in Chicago. They were the largest.
Okay.
Let me see if I can work this magic thing. Well, so far we've heard about solar and wind, which are both incredibly important to us in the future as we move on. But there is no form of energy production that doesn't have some negative connotations. But we're not here to talk about that tonight. And the first thing I want to talk about is nuclear power. I found this quote, and in fact, after reading the quote, I think anyone involved in any of the alternative energy forms could take this exact same quote, which is, the debate is usually too high-tech, polarized, politicized, and hijacked by vested interests. The impact of this debate, in this quote, was nuclear power, will be lived out by our children and grandchildren. I'm a proponent of nuclear power, although in a few minutes you're going to hear from Ginny talking about what is my real favorite, which is just saving power and decreasing your use. There are currently a whole new generation of nuclear plants being built all over the world. There are 11 under construction in China, South Korea, Japan, and Russia. In this country, there are 17 applications that are currently under review by the NRC. None of those have a date for when they will be constructed. As part of the process, you can file and work through the process, and that's something I was working on recently. All of these plants are what they call Generation 3 plants. The current plants that are out there are mostly what were Generation 2. Generation 4 is coming probably in another 10 years, and those are total life cycle plants, they call them. So they take care of their own waste and everything. It's a nice design. But anyway, the Generation 3 plants are several types. There's ABWR, which is an advanced boiling water reactor. The AP1000 is Westinghouse equivalent, which is an advanced pressurized water reactor, and so on. I won't go through all those. But what I do want to stress is all these new designs have used what we've learned in the industry for the past 40 years. And they are typically have more passive elements to the safety systems, less pipe, less valves, better motors, fewer of them, so that they've increased the reliability tremendously. So there's just a couple little drawings to show you folks. Now, when we discussed solar a few minutes ago, we talked about photovoltaic, but there's another kind of solar that actually has a lot of research being done, and this is called tower power typically. And what this amounts to is there's a bunch of articulated mirrors that are motorized, computer controlled, and they focus the light of the sun on a boiler on top of a tower. That boiler then would drive a steam turbine, a steam cycle. If I understand correctly, you could build these in New Mexico and Arizona, and there would be enough sunlight to power the entire needs of the United States. But again, there's negatives associated with these. There's another design which I couldn't find a picture of when I was putting this together, and that uses linear parabolic reflectors, and it runs a tube down through the focal point of those collectors so that it concentrates the sunlight onto that pipe and boils the water that way. And again, they also move to track the sun. It's a very nice system. Geothermal, we're hearing more and more about that for home use these days, or our own schools in that. But that's a topic for later when we're going to talk about some of the things folks can do for themselves. Geothermal literally means heat from the earth, and it's available anywhere, basically, but some of the best locations are where there's geological activity, such as volcanoes or a lot of earthquakes. I'm sure you've all heard the term Ring of Fire, which describes the Pacific Basin, and this is where there's a lot of activity and a lot of good places to put geothermal plants. Two main discussions you have about geothermal. One is the direct use. And if you remember, the Romans used to use hot water coming from the earth for their baths or to heat their homes. So it's been around a long time. And it's also used for electric generation. If you take a look at this plant, this is a example of district heating. Reykjavik, Iceland. I took this picture a couple years ago, but what is so notable in the picture is there are no smokestacks, no chimneys, no little wisps of smoke going up, and the air was so clear that it almost hurt to breathe. It's like you need your pollution, you know. 95% of the homes there are heated this way. Another picture I couldn't find that I wanted to use was one of the electric stations in which the discharge from the electric station, the water went to public swimming pools. It's called Blue Lagoon. It's absolutely beautiful. And the reason I like the picture is because all these people are in the swimming pool. The lifeguard staying there is wearing a parka. So. This country actually is very active with geothermal. As you can see, there's... I'll read it. It's easier. We are the highest user of geothermal, but it's only 0.5%. And a lot of that goes to some of the exact same discussions we've had about PV or wind. It has to do with the regulatory rules. It has to do with the marketplace. It has to do with subsidies. The playing field is not level. California is very big into this, and they have 33 geothermal power plants. And most of the geothermal electricity is in California. Nevada has 14, and Hawaii and Utah each have one. The plants basically come in three shapes, if you will. There's a dry steam plant. This is a plant where they just pipe the steam that's coming out of the earth through and drive their turbines to make electricity. Then there's a flash steam plant, which they extract water from the earth, which is hot, but it's also at high pressure. So they bring it up and they flash it, and it converts the steam, and that drives the turbine. And then they re-inject both of these plants, all three actually, they all re-inject the water back into the earth so that the cycle can continue. And there's binary plants, and the difference here is the binary plant would use that hot water to heat an intermediate fluid that then would drive the turbines. The real benefit there is most of the water coming up with these geothermal plants is just full of minerals and nasty actors, so you don't, it, by going to a binary system, you greatly increase the reliability. Obviously, though, the first cost is much higher. This is a little sketch that just shows the idea of how a plant would work with the extraction well, the power production itself, and then the reinjection well. Next is hydro. Now, we all talked about dams, and we all know how horrible they are. But with the exception of what they do to fishies, they are one of the absolute best, cleanest producers of power we have. Although in the current climate, you'll probably never see another dam built in this country, although China keeps building them. An example of tidal or water power flow, river flow, is back 30, 35 years ago, people talked about the Bay of Fundy. I don't know how many of you are familiar with the Bay of Fundy. They have huge tides, 30, 40-foot tides. And the idea was to put a dam across the mouth of the estuary and literally catch the water on the way in and the way out. So you get two for your money. Never been constructed, but there was a plant built in France that was very successful, an area named Rances. It's a very small plant, though, but it's a proof of concept, if you will. The exciting thing is now we have some new, don't know what they call them. They're turbines. Look an awful lot like a windmill, but they're in the water. And because water is so much denser than air, they can be very small, relatively speaking, to produce the same amount. I have a picture later on to show you of a 1.2 megawatt plant that is in Northern Ireland in the Narrows there. It's absolutely amazing. It'll, you know, provide for, there's a small town near there of about 1,000 homes that it'll take care of their power needs. It, as with a lot of these sustainable power supplies, it doesn't work 24 hours a day, but 18 to 20 is pretty good. I saw this quote that I loved, that they describe these type of hydro units as little wind turbines on steroids. I already discussed the water. Now, the other thing that's very interesting is this has become very popular in this country. There are about 40 applications that were filed in 2006. And there is a site that's fairly well along, although not necessarily close, and it's in New York in the East River. And it's the idea there is that it'll provide power to a shopping center on Roosevelt Island, so it's for a commercial application. The ocean itself, the other forms of energy we hear about quite often, and it's a broad term that's lumped together, everything from wave power, where are designing buoys that as they go up and down, they drive little power generators, devices which use the chemical difference between the surface water and the deep water of the ocean to drive, to make electricity. Plants that use thermal gradients in the ocean, and one that's pretty neat is called, Ocean Thermal Energy Conversion, or OTEC. Now, the way the OTEC systems work is they use the difference between the surface water, which is very hot, relatively speaking, and very deep cold water. And that difference in temperature, all thermodynamic processes, that's how they work, with the difference in temperature. The very nice thing about this design is that it has other supporting uses. If you want to take a quick trip out to Hawaii, it's a long flight, but on the Big Island, Hawaii, there's a place called the Natural Energy Lab. They have a facility there. The facility generates electricity. The discharge water, which from the deep water, is just full of tons of nutrients. And then they take that discharge water and it goes through various ponds where they do things like grow shrimp. They grow algae and seaweed that are dried and exported. The algae is used for pharmaceuticals. The seaweed is used for food. So it's a complete system and a tremendous amount of benefit. There's also talk of making floating OTEC plants. And the reason is that you can use the energy from the OTEC plant for processing chemicals out of seawater. You and I probably don't want one of those plants in our neighborhood, so the floating concept sounds nice. And then, in addition, you wouldn't have power cables or anything else. It would be a standalone unit. Here's a little drawing that shows a typical OTEC setup, the ideal. On the right-hand side is the things that are growing. It's not impressive to see because a lot of the tanks are just plastic sheeting, but it's wonderful what they produce there. And when you go to visit it, they're just so excited about what they're doing that you get a great tour. This is a picture of the plant that is now installed in North Ireland. As you can see, it's got a boom there with two turbines. Only two bladed though, Brent. The last thing I want to talk about is hydrogen. Hydrogen is another power source that we're hearing more and more about. And there's two ways that typically you'll hear about hydrogen discussed. One is fuel cells, and the other will be vehicle fuels. Fuel cell is an electrochemical energy conversion device. Think about it like a battery. But in this case, it uses hydrogen and oxygen, makes water from them, and produces electricity. So it's very clean. In order to produce the hydrogen, the thought is that you would use one of the sustainable forms of power, and that way the full cycle has a very high benefit. These fuel cells are used, well, they've been in the space program for years, that's where we developed them, but also there are some being packaged as power for small shopping centers, hotels, things of this nature, more of a district use rather than a big grid provider. Now, and the use of hydrogen as a fuel can be used with modified internal combustion engines. And also fuel cells can be used in like an electric vehicle. When back in about 1978, I was working for Philadelphia Electric, and I was on the Speakers Bureau, and one of the things, I would go out and talk to high school and middle school science teachers. And I do tend to squirrel away paper, but I didn't save that. The topic was all energy alternatives. It didn't favor nuclear, coal, any of them. What I find most interesting is I probably could have used that speech tonight because we have this dramatic lack of a national energy policy that evaluates what we need and how to do it the cheapest, environmentally safest way. Unfortunately, hopefully this president's going to make a difference there. Thanks.
We've talked about several potential sources of alternative energy, and I think the conclusions that we can reach thus far is probably none of them will be available in the near future to make a significant impact on our need for energy. None of them will be cheap. When Brent and I were talking about this project over the weekend, he made the statement, and he's made it tonight, whatever systems we come up with, we are all going to pay more for energy in the future than we are paying now. We'll probably pay significantly more. Let's change the focus a little bit, because we don't have a quick fix from any of our first three speakers. J.D. Kreitler is going to talk about conservation. Is this a way that in the near future we really need to deal with our dependency on fossil fuels, to really take the fuels that we're using now and to really reduce our use of those fuels? Ginny is president of Kreitler Research and Consulting and has had over 25 years of experience evaluating and planning energy efficiency programs for utilities and public agencies. And she's served as an advisor on energy policy issues to the Pennsylvania Land Trust Association, the Sierra Club, Land Trust Alliance, and other environmental groups. And she's been a contributor to the Pennsylvania Climate Action Plan and the DVRPC Greenhouse Gas Emission Inventory. Ginny, you are on. Let's save the day for us.
You forgot to mention I'm a board member of the Radnor Conservancy.
That's
so.
They didn't need to hear that part. all right. What's the best way to get out of this, John?
A little X in the upper right hand corner.
It's not going to shut the whole PowerPoint down?
Yeah,
that's all right. Yeah, I'll open it up again. All right, we're going to get here. I'm not high tech. See my guess. We'll just leave it as it is. Yeah. All right, I'm going to talk to you tonight about energy efficiency, and the first photograph here may not be obvious to you why it would be in an energy efficiency presentation, but it's sort of an iconic photo for me. It represents what has been going on in my career. I spent 25 years on energy efficiency programs, but that whole time was sort of a frustrated land conservation lover. Got into land conservation on an unpaid basis for the Radnor Conservancy several years ago, but this particular part of the country, which is the Upper Delaware River, is what got me into doing energy policy work for the land conservation community, and this is where the issue of energy policy and land conservation policy intersects most strikingly for me. What happened in 2005 is Congress, under the Bush-Cheney administration, modified the Energy Policy Act and started to promote build-out of interstate transmission lines. And what concerned me about that was that a number of the companies that were moving quickly at that time were really targeting lands that were intended to be conserved permanently. This particular stretch of the Delaware River happened to be designated by our Congress as a wild and scenic recreational stretch of river. The project that was proposed for the 73-mile corridor proposed to use 73 miles of that corridor to site an electric transmission line. Knowing that we had other choices, I felt that I had something to offer to make a little bit of a stink about this. What I'm going to do now is something that I hate when people do in their presentations, and that is going to be to read a quote to you. And I never did this until Mr. Grunewald of Time Magazine wrote this quote at the end of last year. And in 25 years of working in the energy efficiency field, I've never seen anything that put it quite this way. And so I'm going to, bear with me, read through this to you. This may sound too good to be true, but the U.S. has a renewable energy resource that is perfectly clean, remarkably cheap, surprisingly abundant, and immediately available. It has astounding potential to reduce the carbon emissions that threaten our planet, the dependence on foreign oil that threatens our security, and the energy costs that threaten our wallets. Unlike coal and petroleum, it doesn't pollute. Unlike solar and wind, it doesn't depend on the weather. Unlike ethanol, it doesn't accelerate deforestation or inflate food prices.
Unlike nuclear plants, it doesn't raise uncomfortable questions about meltdowns or terrorist attacks or radioactive waste storage, and it doesn't take a decade to build. It isn't what if, like hydrogen, clean coal, and tidal power. It's already proven to be workable, scalable, and cost-effective, and we don't need to import it. So that, in a rather large nutshell, is why I'm here to talk to you about efficiency tonight. Others who advocate for energy efficiency would say that it should be our first resource that we turn to in trying to meet our energy needs. And I want to just break down a little bit what I just went through in that long quote, some of the key reasons why efficiency is such a valuable resource to us. First, there's no footprint. There's no greenhouse gas footprint. There's no on-the-ground footprint. You know, some of our conventional sources of power tend to be damaging in terms of their impact on the air and pollution and emissions. Some of the newer alternative forms of energy are very land consumptive. So there's a trade-off that needs to be made when you determine what types of energy supply you want to go with. Energy efficiency, and what I'm talking about tonight on energy efficiency is technologies and building design that use less energy than other alternatives. And I will be focusing again, as we have been throughout this evening, on utility-implemented programs and public policy that support them. What we have is a 30-year track record in running those kind of programs and a proven level of performance from the leading states that have really been serious about this. It's a very well documented resource, and it's available everywhere. Every community across this whole nation can implement energy efficiency programs. It's available now. There are many options that are commercially available and very cost effective. As was mentioned before, there's varying levels of cost for power. Energy efficiency, when used as a utility resource, is cheaper than any generation option out there. And if you look at the way carbon policies are being constructed, any of the more cost-effective carbon policies will always include efficiency. It's the way to drive down your climate policy costs. This slide shows you what can be done if you implement your policy seriously over a prolonged period of time and really try to make it work. What you're looking at are two curves that show per person energy use in this country for the last 40 years. The top line represents all of us. The lower line represents the state of California. Since the time of the Carter administration, Californians have been implementing expanding and looking at how to diversify and push into all market segments a substantial portfolio of energy efficiency programs. And you can see that over the last three decades, they've achieved real impact there. They've been able to hold per capita usage flat while the rest of us increased at a rate of 9% a year. Here's what it looks like for the state of Pennsylvania. This report just came out like 2 weeks ago, produced by the American Council for Energy Efficient Economy, shows what we can expect our energy usage and the electrical sector to look like if we don't change our policies at all. There's no reason for us not to change our policies. And in fact, last year the state did start to make some changes legislatively to further promote energy efficiency. But because we are late into the game here in Pennsylvania, there's a huge amount of untapped potential for energy efficiency gains here. And because there's 30 years of experience in other states and a lot of demonstrated success to draw from, we can very quickly put into place a lot of effective and cost-effective programs here. This is another chart from that same report. It shows you a projection of a specific portfolio of programs taking from things that have worked well elsewhere and applying projections to the state of Pennsylvania. If we implemented the same type of programs here, what would it do to electrical demand in our state? This is assuming, much as Brett's information showed you what would happen just applying wind to the mix. This is looking at just efficiency programs, and we can see that efficiency programs offer enough potential that we could stop the growth. If you look at the lower line there, that would be the amount of growth in electrical use, not growth, it would be actual electrical use statewide. So we can actually begin to drive down statewide use in electricity if we seriously commit to energy efficiency programs. Now, that's a pretty high bar to achieve. Not too many states have gotten there quite yet. The state of Vermont was the first one in the nation to actually produce that effect. Overall, statewide electrical use has been brought down through implementation of energy efficiency programs. This report that just came out also quantified other benefits to us in addition to saving energy and saving on greenhouse gas emissions. It would have positive effects on the economy and job production, increase in wages, and also the programs that would be offered through the utilities to promote these more efficient technologies. The customers who participate in them will see lower energy bills by virtue of participating in those programs. Last year, our state legislature passed a new law, Act 129, is being implemented just now. You probably would not have heard of it because the utilities are still going through a planning process to define which programs they'll be implementing. They are required to file those plans by July of this year. So later this year or next year at the latest, these programs will be hitting the street. There'll be various types of incentives offered depending on the specific programs that are selected. There'll probably be a host of rebates or maybe loans or maybe free design assistance. You know, it remains for July to show us exactly what the party bag of, you know, opportunities will be for consumers here. But what the state has done is they've set savings targets for the utilities to achieve by the year 2011 and again by the year 2013. And they are to reduce their total sales of electricity in their system by the numbers shown here, or they will be faced with penalties, which could be up into the millions of dollars. So the legislature would like to see this be taken seriously, and it looks like everything is being done well to put this into place. This is going to be benefit to us all. As you saw earlier, the costs of power vary. This graph shows similar numbers to what we saw before. It also happens to play around with carbon policies, and if you start to add costs for carbon, how do these scenarios play out? What you'll see is at the far left-hand end there, energy efficiency is much cheaper than all the sources of power that are out there, and it remains constantly cheap as you add prices into the mix for carbon because energy efficiency emits no carbon. Now, I want to make the point that those numbers for energy efficiency are not theoretical numbers. It's not like you give money to the banking industry and the insurance industry and you don't know where it goes. The numbers that are shown here are numbers from several of the states that have really put into place serious policies from state regulators onto the utilities to implement energy efficiency programs. Those programs are all evaluated every year with statistically, you know, representative sampling of the customers who participated, metering. You know, these programs are measured. They're tested for cost effectiveness. If they're not cost effective, they either try to fix them or they throw them out and go to something else that's cost effective. So when people talk about efficiency being a low cost option, it is extremely well measured. So here's what we're looking at. The Department of Energy and EPA a couple years ago came out with a National Action Plan for Energy Efficiency for our country. And in that report, which lays out, you know, why this is a good idea and some of the benefits of it, you know, their estimate is that the U.S. could save many billions of dollars by going to efficiency in a larger way. That's been borne out by analyses at a state level. We expect to see over $1 billion in benefits here in Pennsylvania from implementing efficiency policies. The new bills that are being introduced to address carbon policy, also those policies become more cost effective by including energy efficiency into your mix here. Here's one way that that could work. This is an analysis if you just basically taxed carbon, the lower slope shown there is, you know, the effect, you know, how do people change their behavior in response to changes in prices in their electricity. And electricity use is fairly price inelastic. You don't get a lot of change in usage of electricity for the changes in prices. So price changes alone are not the best way to go after trying to achieve an impact. If you took the money that would be generated by that carbon tax and invested that money into energy efficiency programs, you could increase your impact sevenfold by reinvesting that money in that way. How much of a difference is that really going to make? Well, as you heard before, Pennsylvania is one of the most serious emitters in our country for carbon emissions, and that's because of our high use of coal-fired power, and we actually are a net exporter of power to other states, so we all share the benefits of the greenhouse gas emissions from our coal plants. The states to our east and our north, 10 states are involved in the Regional Greenhouse Gas Initiative. It's an interstate compact to try to implement for the first time effective carbon policies in our country. One of the biggest threats to that compact is that power producers sited in states outside that area could use power plants that would not meet the standards of that compact and sell power into that area. Pennsylvania is one of the states they're looking at as one of the largest threats there. This analysis that's shown here is from a report that was issued by the Union of Concerned Scientists in December of last year. It's a little hard to see that graphic, I'm sure. The bar graph on the right-hand side shows the amount of carbon reduction benefit that is anticipated from this compact in the year 2019. The smokestacks next to that show you different ways that coal-fired power plant use could easily wipe out the entire effects of that compact, you know, 10 years down the road from now. The compact was just implemented as of January this year, so you're looking at impacts for the year 2019 after it's fully ramped up. And what those other items in that graph are showing you is that through a couple different scenarios, building new coal-fired power plants or even just building power lines that would enable them to move their power to new markets, just increased use of existing plants that are now underutilized is very substantial. And so what we choose to do, building out the grid or saving energy or going to clean power sources, makes a huge amount of difference relative to our climate policies. So if it's low cost and it's a wonderful thing to do for the environment and it's got all these benefits, why is this not happening? If it's been proven effective for 30 years or more, why are we not doing this? The reason for it is we don't have a regulation of the utilities set up properly. Historically, utility rates are set up so that the more power they sell, the more profitable they are. And energy efficiency programs, by design, lower the amount of power that they sell. So if you don't redesign your rates to reflect that as a desired outcome of what you're trying to do through your utilities, you have a built-in disincentive for management and the utilities to really get behind these programs. So what's needed to make this really, you know, kick off is to change how the rates are designed. And there are a number of states that have started to tackle this issue to the point where you can start to take a look at the numbers and what kind of effects are those having. There's two kinds of incentives that I'm representing here. The one that's called rate decoupling is really changing that basic rate design, getting away from the volumetric sales approach. So if you have more volume of sales, you're more profitable, breaking that connection. The Obama administration is advancing this by making part of the recovery money contingent on the states saying that they will put in place policies to decouple rates. So if you want that piece of the pie for the recovery money, you have to agree to do that. Performance incentives would be offering more financial return to the utilities if they achieve or exceed targets that are set for their program. So there's two ways to go about it. They have fairly comparable impacts in terms of effects on usage, and it's nearly additive effects. Another way to go on this is energy efficiency resource standard. It's the efficiency equivalent to the renewable portfolio standards. You set a target for the utilities to meet. This is something that's not as widely used for efficiency now as it is for renewables. It's gaining some ground. Most of the time, all of the energy efficiency resource standards that exist do address what we call end user efficiency. That's, you know, efficiency in the building where the consumer consumes the power. Some of the more progressive policies also include other kinds of upgrades to the electrical grid system itself. Not all of them do that. Those programs can be put in place fairly quickly. To date, they've been quite varied in their design. There's not a lot of national consistency to that. I'm not going to go through this in detail, just to show you the first program started 10 years ago in Texas. They were actually able to meet their 10% target quite easily, and have now doubled that target. So it's working for them. We have a standard here in the state of Pennsylvania. The Act 129 that I mentioned earlier is our energy efficiency standard that we have implemented. This map shows you there's, you know, a lot of gaps nationwide as to where these have or haven't been implemented. There was a bill introduced Friday on the House that would include energy efficiency resource standards. It includes a lot. It is like the mother of all climate bills. It started out as 648 pages when it was introduced Friday. As of today, it's close to 1,000 pages in length with all the amendments that have been offered. So lots of ideas in Congress about how to go forward with climate policy. This is one piece of it. Just to give you an idea of how that looks, I believe that House bill has the same targets as the numbers here, which come from two bills on the Senate side in terms of what type of targets they're trying to hit there. And on the right is our piece of legislation that we passed here in Pennsylvania, so to give you an opportunity to contrast that. We have set a target of 1% sales reduction by 2011. The federal laws, if passed and implemented, would start a year later. They ramp up and have targets by year all the way out to 2020. Ours just set a target through 2013, and then at that point, the legislature, the Public Utilities Commission will revisit what kind of success we've had and set new goals. Even if we don't set new goals, if the federal law goes into place, it would continue to move us forward and making progress on energy efficiency. And another way that the administration is committing to efficiency is a lot of direct investment programs in the recovery bill. So for the first time in many, many years, we're going to see a real commitment to energy efficiency as a resource that we're really going to try to use as part of the energy mix that we're asking our utilities to draw upon. And it's highly beneficial direction for us to go in. It's the least cost resource out there. It's cleaner than anything else you can do. It's going to make our carbon policies, should we choose to implement them, more cost effective, more palatable politically because the costs are lower. We can also hope to see, and this has been done in some places like the Pacific Northwest, using energy efficiency to get away from building new capacity. I mean, you can implement it on a scale, as we saw that graph for the state of Pennsylvania, to reduce demand enough that you can, target, you can really target, you know, deferring or displacing upgrades to the transmission system or construction of new power plants. And what we need, as has been discussed before, is a commitment to the right kind of policies and an investment in those programs. So my parting words would be to really say that efficiencies should be the first resource in our energy mix, and we have a lot of opportunity ahead of us now with the new administration. Thank you.
I think if I could summarize in one sentence everything we've heard thus far tonight is that if we're going to make a substantial impact on our dependency on fossil fuels, we're going to have to devote substantial resources to everything that's been talked about tonight, including conservation. At this point, I'd like to open the floor to questions. Please come up to the microphone. I don't care whether you have your back to us or back to the audience. Identify yourself and ask your question. While people are formulating questions, I have a question for the panel myself here. There's been fleeting references to the grid. My question, particularly to the two of you, is the logical places to put up wind turbines and solar panels are places where people don't live to any large extent. How do we get the energy that's generated from all those windmills that you're going to put in North Dakota to the people in Chicago and all those solar plants that you're going to build in Arizona, where there is a population, to the people that live in Texas and California? And how do we deal with the grid problem? Is the grid system adequate to deal with where we are now?
Well, with respect to solar, solar PV, for the most part, when you're net metering it, doesn't require new transmission. You're using it at the location in which it's needed. So those were the type of solar projects I was primarily talking about, and I think there's a great opportunity to use the existing rooftops we have all over this country and to offset loads right where the energy is used, that thus not requiring additional transmission. Now, there is the solar that was talked about in a later talk, concentrated solar thermal and those types of power plants where you would need to build new transmission. But I think that's one of the benefits that solar does provide, solar photovoltaics, when it's net metered, and isn't really reflected in the overall evaluation of the cost.
Okay.
Brent?
There's no one at the mic for questions, so I will comment. There is a sub debate within the policy world in addition to the sources of generation, and that's the location of generation. That's what you're getting to. And some of the most fascinating models for what we could do for electric generation are, in my view, how we can get more distributed generation, generation at the source. And again, efficiency is first. So, John, I don't think you were trying to get a debate among this group here, but you certainly couldn't if you tried, because the only debate here is against inaction. We will need all of it. A very efficient, very dirty electric system isn't going to do anything for us. And a very inefficient, very clean will work, but it's very expensive. So there's no doubt that efficiency is first. And then you get to the debate of how do we provide electricity from there. And in my view, solar and small wind, the reason I showed the picture of Atlantic City is that's five wind turbines behind the meter at a sewage treatment plant. So that's not using transmission. That's eliminating transmission because that's generating power at the source. Most big wind and big solar and nuclear and big solutions are going to need more transmission. So it's part of the debate. We'll need transmission from South Dakota into Chicago, from Arizona, under some theories, all the way to the Northeast if we use big central stations. So the real debate is, and I also wouldn't put it quite maybe as hopeless as you might have inadvertently suggested, John, and that is we actually can do this. It's a matter of, as we all said, unleashing the policy and making decisions and then moving, because it's 50% coal, remember, and the question is who's going to replace that carbon-producing segment? So you saw aggressive efficiency that got to 4.5%, maybe 10%. If you use California. That's still not 50% of coal. So efficiency's first. Quick story. When you can pay more for wind generation from PICO right now. You can select it under PICO Wind. And for me, even though I've always known, and you've always known that efficiency is the first resource, you know when I actually first started doing it? Is when I signed up to pay 30% more for electricity. Just when I put down the pen, I started looking around thinking, where can I get that 30% back? You know, that's just how we are, human nature. So what it's really going to be is a commitment to pay more for electricity to get it cleaned up, and then we'll save the 30% back. I now have more compact fluorescents in the house, you know, and I put my house up against anyone as to whether I'm efficient. And as soon as I convinced my wife that compact fluorescents look good in my Christmas things, which I tried one, she took it right out, didn't work at all, doesn't have any sparkle. You know, as soon as I convince her that, we'll get to the Christmas lights and the Porsche lights. But, you know, we're just humans, and we got to get there by commitment. So the commitment is we're going to pay more for, to clean up the grid, and then we're going to save the rest on efficiency. And whether we do it with transmission lines or not, my personal bet is that actually solar is the next resource that wins the battle. And I say the battle. Efficiency and wind, I'm telling you, are already there. So it's not a matter of waiting. The prices are there for efficiency and wind. And for the rest of the coal segment, it's either going to be coal that sequesters carbon, which I think is pretty unlikely, but the coal folks will tell you that's the one, or nuclear, or solar. And I think it's solar. That's where I'd put my bets on sequestering carbon from coal versus, we'll get some more nuclear. Nuclear has a role, and I agree with John on that, particularly existing plants and some new ones, and then efficiency and wind, and then you still need some more, and I think it's solar. And so it's a big growth industry.
Okay. Rick, come on up. Oh, yeah, well, that may be the best bet. Why don't you just use the hand mic and then
Okay. Try again. Test.
Yes.
Great.
That works, yes.
This question, I guess, is for everyone, and it's a good segue to what you were just talking about. As you know, in Pennsylvania, land use is locally controlled and governed, and we have a robust resident advocacy culture here, less charitably known as a NIMBY culture. In a lot of areas.
Not in
Radnor, no. But I'm wondering if you're seeing any policy shifts or any political will, both either federally or at the state level, that'll counteract that. I know, for instance, the 1996 Telecommunications Act required co-location of antennas, but also gave some teeth to zoning preemption to allow these folks to get these antennas up for the public good. I wonder if you're seeing anything similar.
Yeah, the answer is absolutely yes. And this is manifesting itself on the transmission front and on the renewable power front. There's a number of bills on the Senate side dealing with both of those sectors of the industry, and it is the intent of the sponsors of those bills to facilitate the siting of renewable generation and of transmission. So the answer is clearly yes. The hope is to move the decision-making process to the federal level. Oversight of transmission at this point in time, and it has always been the responsibility of the states. So the policymakers in D.C. do want to see that changed. The different bills have different components to them. Senator Reid is actually proposing a bill in advancing renewable power that would go through a planning process to designate renewable energy zones. And so what that intent would be is to identify areas that are well suited to solar and to wind, maybe other things, but definitely those. Identify where those resources are strong, look at how they are located relative to where the demand centers are, and set up a process for moving quickly on allowing for the siting of that and the transmission to connect them into the grid.
I'd like to make a comment on that as well. In Pennsylvania, there's a solar working group that's been working on ordinances for siting solar, particularly on residential. And the other thing is that the PADP has been very fast track on getting any land development permits for larger scale solar. So they put all resources right now, that's their focus. So if you have a project that you're developing, they will fast track it through the permitting process.
I think a perfect example of the NIMBYism, and this is, I'm looking at you, Brent, because this is the wind related. As probably most of you know, the Kennedys and others have been very successful in preventing the construction of wind turbines in the ocean off of Nantucket and I think Martha's Vineyard. Does anything change there, or is that project still dead in the water, so to speak?
The companies I'm with have not invested a lot of time in offshore ocean wind for some of those reasons. Europe has adopted it, so it may come, but siting is part of the issue. And I'd be interested actually in John's view on nuclear and siting, because I think the reason solar prices are coming down, wind's for the balance, whatever wind can't do, you can only put wind where people want it. Like I say, in some rural areas with economic development and the agricultural income, people want it. So it's going to go in there. And the rest, and nuclear, I don't know where that's going to go in. I'd be interested in John's views. But solar doesn't have much siting issues. You know, you can put it on the roof. It's expensive, but it's this whole thing of efficiency versus expense. That's why my personal view, doesn't matter what it is, but my personal view is solar is going to win the balance in the end, because prices are going to come down, electricity prices are going to go up, we'll save what we can with efficiency, and solar wins the siting war. But I would love personally to hear what John says about that, because it's solar or nuclear, in my view.
Sounds like a challenge.
Yeah.
No, actually,
I'm pretty pro-nuclear for renewable energy person.
Nuclear plants are big. The newest designs are 1,400 megawatts, 1.4 gigawatts. They take a lot of area, and although they're incredibly safe, you don't want to be in a population center. So there we get into the transmission issues. When we first sited Limerick, there was no Route 422 or going up there. It was just back roads. And I did emergency preparedness at that time, so I had to look at evacuations of the area. Well, the population around Limerick now is probably three or four times higher than when we built the plant. So they're the issues you have to deal with there. I just favor something to go along with a point Jenny made that folks may not know about. Back in the 1980s, there was a nuclear power plant near Sacramento, California, and it was owned by the Sacramento Municipal Utilities District. It was a 1,000-megawatt plant, single unit, Now, the SMUD is owned by the voters that live in that area, and they wanted the plant shut down. Well, by using energy efficiency techniques, for example, they would, if you had an old refrigerator, they'd give you a new refrigerator. They were able to completely offset that plant being shut down. So it's dramatic what it can do.
Yeah, I would just add to that point, you all may remember what Enron did to California with the blackouts and brownouts that they experienced there at the worst of, you know, that period of time. Because California had this established infrastructure of delivering energy efficiency programs, they were able, within a 12-month period, you have a peak time of the year, summer air conditioning use is what really drives the system to its capacity. They were able, between the one summer when they had the program problems and the next summer, to increase the capacity of the programs that they were delivering and customer participation to the point where that next year they didn't have those reliability problems again. So it really is a resource that's terribly underutilized but can make a real manifest difference in how our power system operates.
I just want to say one more thing about siting with respect to nuclear versus solar. Not that we're doing the versus, but one of the issues that we're seeing is water use, and nuclear power does require quite a bit of water. And so in California particularly, with we've worked with the several utility districts, irrigation districts, and one of the things they like about solar is that there's no water requirement, whereas there's other forms of energy that they use or would could use that have that water requirement. And I think as we go along, we understand that water is really becoming a very scarce resource. So I think that will play a role in siting issues.
Dan, before we get to you, Rick's been standing for a long time back there. Let's let him.
With regard to water use, you can build dry cooling towers. Palo Verde is outside of Phoenix, and it's three units, and it uses dry cooling towers. Very small amount of water. Now, what they had done was, way back when, they made a deal with the local sanitary district to take the water after it had been treated. And ever since then, the sanitary district's been trying to buy that back from them. It's pretty interesting.
Thank you all. Yes. Thank you, John. I think many of us are interested in what we can do on a residential level.
That's our next topic.
Seriously?
Yeah.
That's
our topic for next.
My question would be, what resources do we turn to understand how to select vendors and products and systems in general from, you know, the generation and also the energy efficiency.
Yeah, I don't want to cut you off, but tonight's discussion is kind of on the macro level. What are the big picture problems?
Well,
in the fall,
course,
we are planning
of
a.
Of course, I appreciate that, because I think that's going to be the.
Oh yeah, no,
the,
no,
the,
we're
the major challenge that we have to face. But you know, from a personal level, I'm happy to hear that. You know, that'll be upcoming.
Well, I think hopefully everybody will understand, will take away from this, that although President Obama has set all these lofty goals for us, this is not going to be easy. And as individual homeowners, you know, we're going to have to be doing some things on our own. And solar certainly is one of them, and geothermal may be another one. There are a lot of things that we as individual homeowners can do to help our own pocketbooks and at the same time help the economy.
Is that scheduled now? I mean, can you answer
it
that?
Will be in the fall. I can't give you a specific date.
Okay.
But once again, if you did not sign in, please sign in the way out so we have your email address and you will be on the distribution list for that seminar, which will be September, October. I'm not sure what the specific date is at this point.
Thank you.
If you have any specific questions you want to ask the panelists tonight, but we will be dealing with that topic in detail next.
Can I just
say
something quickly that I don't think will steal the thunder of the program, upcoming program? There is a rebate available now in the state for solar, residential solar. And the Pennsylvania DEP web page, they're certifying installers to be eligible to receive that rebate on behalf of the customer. So PADEP webpage would be a good resource to begin your research and in looking at that.
Thanks.
And there are also substantial tax credits that are available, too.
I mean, there's a lot going on. And
I think all of my neighbors are replacing their windows right now.
Energy efficiency, yeah.
Thanks.
Also, Rick, something you can do right now is support our local legislators. I mean, Greg Vitale has been a real driving force in this stuff in the state.
Right.
His website, his state website, has a lot of good links on it, too.
Thanks.
Well, just give that to Dan.
Thank you. First of all, I want to thank the group for the excellence of the presentations made tonight. They are really heavy and in good content, and I appreciate the effort very much. I have a series of questions, not necessarily connected. Even though we're putting out a lot of carbon through electrical power plants and so on, there's China and Indonesia and Africa, and also there's methane. Nobody mentioned methane. I mean, the cows deliver methane in great quantities. Methane is 20 times or 19 times more destructive for ozone and greenhouse than CO2. Any comments on that?
The only thing I'd say to start is there are other areas other than electrical generation that we're going to have to work on. And the agricultural industry is one of personal interest to me. But the fact is electric generation, even considering methane's effects, is 40% worldwide, globally. And so to get your point on China, China is building 4,000 megawatt coal plants. They did in 2008. So you're right. It's a global climate. And some in the U.S. would say, you know, we can't start working on it until we get everybody on board. Fact is, we're still the largest part of the climate problem in the U.S., and so we probably have to lead the way by starting at home. But it's not easy to see how we get everybody on board, I'll give you that.
As you know, the CO2 level worldwide is about 345 parts per million, or within a couple of that. Isn't it going to take 75 to 100 years, even if we didn't kick in at the same rate, for that effect to dilute back down?
Yeah, we can expect, even if we did, you know, an extremely aggressive push on reducing carbon right now, we are still going to see for the next 30 years minimum an increase in carbon levels in our atmosphere. It's, at least that's what all of the modeling consistently seems to show, is that we've already reached a point where carbon levels will be increasing even, you know, under the best of scenarios. Now, you know, of course, if we don't take proactive steps, you know, it'll be an even worse case than that. But you're right. We're destined for more carbon in the atmosphere and the effects that that will bring.
On solar PV, talk about thin film technology costs versus standard PV technology today, cost-wise, and
sure.
When is it coming?
Well, thanks for bringing that up, because one of the things that I didn't have a chance to cover is the various PV technologies and how they impact cost, efficiency, and implementation. And so thin-film solar is generally less efficient but lower cost. And we do both crystalline and thin film, and what we've seen is that when the prices of steel and wire go up, you really lose the savings on the thin film technology because you have more balance of system. What we're seeing, though, is there's an oversupply in crystalline right now, and so we're definitely seeing crystalline silicon prices go down. Overall, I would say, depending upon the application, sometimes thin film is cheaper, sometimes it isn't, and that's what we're seeing.
On a state payback, or the metering where you get back something from the power company,
Is that on a one-to-one basis? Do they take out transmission costs, or what do they? How is that figured?
That is on a one-to-one basis. You get all the transmission, distribution, and electricity savings cost.
Elaborate a little bit what you mean on a one-to-one basis.
Well, that was your term. So when you offset the electricity, you're also offsetting the transmission and distribution costs that goes associated with that. So you're saving the overall cost.
Because PICO charges is, what, about 15, 16 cents a kilowatt hour now?
That's pretty much what it is right now for residential, yeah.
And my last point is I always get an internal chuckle out of people setting goals in legislatures and in the government. You know, the efficiencies that are going to be achieved are based on physical principles. I mean, you know, there's so much you can get heat energy out of a Carnot cycle on a gasoline engine. And all the laws in Congress and all the goodwill is not going to change that. Metering techniques may help, but, you know, when we're talking about efficiencies, there's also the power plant efficiencies, not just the home efficiencies and insulation efficiencies. But I'm amazed at the gas efficiencies on home furnaces, where the old 20 years ago it was in the 80-81%, and now you're getting up at 94-97% by heat recovery techniques. Really an excellent job that you, the group, have done. Thank you.
Thank you.
I'd like to say something about efficiency with respect to solar, because this is kind of a thing that bugs me. So we talk about the efficiency of the module, but 100% of the, so it's the percentage of energy that hits that solar module that's converted to electricity. And so right now we're looking at efficiencies. The most efficient modules are about 22%. But the sunlight hitting that is free versus what you do in a gasoline engine. So that's just my little bugaboo on efficiency.
And I have to add one more point, too, John, before we let you speak. On the efficiency programs, what you're looking at is not Dan's point on, you know, technological efficiency or physical efficiency improvements, but on the efficiency programs, what you're really talking about is market penetration, human behavior, and adoption of technology options that are out there. And we are so far from getting even close to what's technically achievable, or let alone what's cost effective. We have great room for improvement, and all we really need to do is put the right incentives in place to change human behavior.
Let me just say one thing before I let about methane. One of the things that we're seeing with some of our landfill clients is, of course, landfills produce a lot of methane. And now we have companies that are taking the methane from the landfills and using that, burning it, using it as an alternative energy source and adding the electricity to the grid. So there are lots of possibilities out there. A lot of the cottage industries that can be developed to develop alternative energy sources. You're on, sir.
Thank you. Firstly, thank you all for coming in this great presentation. Each and every one of you have enriched all of us with some of this information, so thank you.
Well, we hope we haven't been too discouraging. That's the one thing. There are no easy fixes here, but I think everybody needs to understand that.
Well, and I'll have to say I'm with Rick. You know, when I can bring the efficiency of my own home up and save some energy that way, I'll feel like I'm contributing to all of us and to me as well.
Exactly.
I've heard in discussions at this level, not in my home level, but at the macro level, concerns about both solar and wind when it comes to storing the power and the cost balance that you will get back from the utilities for that power, since it doesn't necessarily come at when they'd like it to, like a coal plant. You know, those rail cars keep coming in, that coal keeps firing, that electricity keeps coming on every time they ask for it, and it powers a grid along a very steady efficiency, if you will. What is the answer there, or what are at least the concepts in that direction?
I'll start with wind. The answer there is 20%. The reason I said wind can provide 20% of the answer, 20% of the electricity, is because that's the level at which intermittency is best used with other resources. And it was originally said wind could provide 5% or 6 or 7%. But the fact is, Europe has shown us that you can have a very stable grid. Spain actually has less grid downtime than we do in the U.S. They laugh at our reliability standards in Spain, and they have a very high percentage from wind. So the fact is, you can do it. There are a couple of interesting phenomena that happen when you get enough wind. It turns out that when you don't have wind in one place, you often have it in another, and you get some diversity of wind. And a lot of interesting things happen. But basically, 20% is the conservative number from wind. And beyond that, I think what's also interesting is we built so much natural gas peaking during the deregulation era of the last 10 years that we essentially now have a hybrid electric grid that you can use all this natural gas peaking capacity that we built to firm up our renewable and efficiency and other resources. So it's essentially like a hybrid car where you use the battery until you need to fire up the gasoline engine and you double your gas mileage. We can now use all our natural gas peaking capacity to firm up wind when it's not blowing and use the free resource that Sarah's talking about when it's available. So that's the answer on wind. It's 20% before you bump into real intermittency issues. And we're at, remember, 1 or 2% now. So we still have a way to go. It's kind of like that efficiency. You don't have to talk about technical efficiency yet. Let's just do what's cost effective first.
I'll just speak a little bit about solar. What we've seen with solar is that it has a very reliable, predictable output curve when the sun is shining. And there's certain places in the country where it shines more frequent, you know, more often than others. Sure. But we look at 30-year weather data, and we can predict the annual output of a system that meets that output that we predicted. So for solar, it wouldn't be a dispatchable resource, but it's something that can take care of the base load. And certainly it performs best during peak times when, you know, energy is the most expensive. But we can't guarantee that it's going to perform because we might have a rainstorm. So, but it is a good base load, so you can kind of bring down the overall base load. We don't recommend it for peak load necessarily.
And that's really the heart of the question is.
Storage.
It's in my mind, it's a balance. You have all this coal over here, and.
Well, I think that's the mix issue.
Yeah.
That there isn't one solution. I think that's really the message, that it's a combination of solutions. And so solar, when you're using it at your house, for example, you're net metering. And at nighttime, the sun isn't shining, so you're using the grid power. But you're reducing a lot of the load during the day, hopefully in peak times, and you're also not requiring additional transmission to be built. The other thing that we found is that it can help constrained areas on the grid. So if you have solar deployed in areas where there's often blackouts or difficulty getting that resource to that location on the grid, congested areas like in a city, solar can be very helpful. But from my standpoint, the message is really you need the mix.
I just have to say one more thing on this. I know you're not, but I think it's easily used as a reason for inaction. And remember, that's the only enemy, as far as I'm concerned. You heard we're going to have baked in climate change from what we've already done. So in my view, I'd set a 5-year goal to eliminate carbon generation, and it is actually doable. And the reason it's doable is we have the technology now to do a combination of resources, even with intermittent resources, which is efficiency, nuclear, existing nuclear fleet, wind and solar, and demand-side reductions on the generation side, and then you firm it up with natural gas. And that is a very, very clean grid. It's not 100% because you have some natural gas, but it is a very, very clean. It's, you know, 80% of the way, and that's a huge improvement on making a difference. So the notions about, well, you know, we need baseload coal, I just think don't stand up. We could actually clean up the grid in 5 years using our natural gas peaking and the resources we already have, in my view. Includes the nuclear fleet, includes wind, includes solar, includes efficiency, and includes natural gas. But that is a clean energy solution that I think you could do very, very quickly.
Is that on the ballot tomorrow, by the way?
Yeah. That's what needs to be. That's what needs to happen.
Yeah.
John, I look forward to the other presentation in the fall.
All right,
Thank you for this.
We will be notifying. We have time for one more question if we have any more questions. Come on up. You're the final question of the evening. Not to put you on the spot.
So it better be a good one or a short one?
Well, both.
Okay. In that mix, you haven't mentioned geothermal.
Well, we did talk about geothermal a little bit, yeah.
Well, I'm sorry, I apologize, but what...
Before John gives you the answer on geothermal generation, I would just add very quickly, I put geothermal in the demand reduction for geothermal heat. We just put it in our home last year. It is dynamite. I mean, it is just great. It's taking heat out of the earth and taking cooling out of the earth summer and winter. And yes, I'm paying for electricity to do that, but about a third of what I'd be using if I were actually using electricity from nuclear or coal generation to actually heat a resistive element. So the first thing I'd say on geothermal is we will see, and we need to see a lot more geothermal heat installations, you know, in homes. That's not a source of generation. That's just using geothermal heat. And then John can comment on the rest.
Is geothermal available on a large scale? I mean, will it become a major source of energy in this country?
I don't believe it's ever going to be, you know, a gigawatt plant. But where geothermal really works well is for districts, like small towns, because it has that kind of density. And where there's sources, it's a great resource. I read an article recently where up in Alaska, one of these small towns that's out in the middle of nowhere, we used to use a diesel engine to make their electricity. And they have, because there is seismic activity in Alaska, they were able to drill down and they're using geothermal now to generate their electricity.
Is it likely to be used on an individual building basis?
For electricity, I doubt. It could for heating
but
and cooling.
But replacing heating and cooling?
Oh, yes, absolutely.
Yeah, and isn't heating and cooling a major part of the energy used in a
yes.
building? Okay. So I guess what my preference would be for distributed power generation, the use of geothermal, and then you wouldn't need such a big backup for those peak periods or periods when the sun isn't shining or the wind isn't blowing. My own bias against wind generation is that I think it's going to be very tough on birds and bats to generate the 20% that you're talking about. Between forest fragmentation and putting those turbines up and the actual strikes to animals. Thank you.
Thank you all very
much.
The
only thing I'd have to say on the avian issue is each cat kills more birds per year than each turbine. So if you want to really help the bird issue, we need to bring in some cats first. Unless you can get energy out of the cats.
I don't think I'd like to comment on that, but I've encouraged all my friends to keep their cats indoors. But estimates for bird fatality from striking windows, towers, and wind turbines is upwards of 1 billion birds a year. So that's a lot of birds.
Yeah, in fact, the studies on that, we are actually leading one of the studies on bat fatalities and finding ways to mitigate them. But the fact is, if you are concerned about birds and bats, you start with buildings and cars because the percentage from wind turbines is barely visible compared to glass buildings and other things. But it's an example of how we need it all ties together, and we need to do it in a responsible way.
Thank you all for coming. Stay tuned for our discussion in the fall. Again, please sign the sign-up sheet so we have your email address and we can alert you when we have a date for the fall. Thanks again.